In the early to mid-1970s, America experienced perhaps the biggest political scandal in the nation's modern history. The man who had risen to the top had now lied to everyone who got him there. What were the motives behind the scandal, and what is still being hidden from Americans to this day? On June 17, 1972, a group of five burglars broke into the Democratic National Committee headquarters at the Watergate building in the nation's capital. One of the five men arrested was James McCord, a security contractor for President Richard Nixon. The next day, Nixon spoke to Chief of Staff H.R. Haldeman in a taped conversation. In 1973, after Nixon's re-election landslide, the scandal began to unfold. Haldeman resigned later that spring, and Senate Majority Leader Mike Mansfield opened the investigation as to if Nixon's administration was involved. A White House aide named Alexander Butterfield revealed Nixon's insane methods of recording past talks and meetings. Nixon agreed to let the tapes be transcribed by his secretary, Rosemary Woods, and they would have Mississippi Senator John Stennis verify the contents to make sure they were accurate. The tapes were released in April 1974, and facing an unwinnable impeachment and trial and conviction in the House and Senate, Nixon resigned on August 8, 1974.
My fellow Americans, this is not a dub. This is not a dub conversation. I'm not a crook. But I'm unrelated now, I shall resign effective at noon tomorrow.
1 month later, on September 8, 1974, his successor, President Gerald Ford, pardoned Richard Nixon. The tapes were still missing a crucial piece of information, though. Nixon's summer 1972 call with H.R. Haldeman. Rosemary Woods said she might have deleted part of the tapes by reaching over and grabbing the phone, while also pushing a pedal on the machine to override it. However, historians say that the stretch she supposedly held for 5 minutes seemed unrealistic. Prosecutors were convinced that America was sick of Watergate, and so no effort was made initially to rediscover the tapes. Multiple efforts have failed to discover any sort of information on the tapes over the years, and Nixon and Haldeman both died in 1994 and 1993, respectively. Many ideas of who deleted the tapes and what was in them have been discussed over the years. 2014, White House Councilman John Dean revealed his idea of the lost tapes, saying he thought the phone was just general comments by Nixon and Haldeman, potentially Nixon's first sign of involvement. However, this doesn't seem likely, since all of this information might have just been in other tapes anyway. Looking at the beginning of the call, Nixon and Haldeman talked sending a letter to the governor of South Dakota, the home state of his 1972 Democratic rival George McGovern. Then the talk shifts to the break-ins and then goes blank. Haldeman kept notes, but they were checked for cleanness by Nixon's staff and were much shorter than normal. When checked for indented writing, there was just an illegible signature, likely from Haldeman. Nixon also claimed not to know of the break-ins before he got involved, but said,
"My God, the committee isn't worth bugging, in my opinion. That's my public line."
This suggests that Nixon might have known more about the break-in behind the scenes. Former White House aide Jeb Magruder said he heard Nixon commission the break-in to campaign manager John Mitchell, though this is unconfirmed. Haldeman himself said regarding the contents of the tapes that it might have been to denigrate Democratic Party chair Lawrence O'Brien. In terms of who deleted the tapes, Woods is likely out due to the impossibility of her holding the stretch for an extended period. The tape was already likely partially deleted, and the buzz she heard made her think she did it. She walked in and told Nixon that she might have deleted the tapes, and Nixon and his new chief of staff, Alexander Haig, drove around Washington for 2 hours. The biggest topic discussed was likely the resignation of Vice President Spiro Agnew, but more erasings of the tapes were made after the ride, meaning that was also likely discussed. He also started all of his grand jury defense about the situation with "I don't recall," and repeatedly ensured that the ride was all about Agnew to a suspicious degree. Many attempts have been made to restore the tapes, but they are being held in private at risk of damaging them. In the short term, the Watergate scandal damaged the overall Republican image and cost many Republican congressional leaders their seats in the 1974 midterms. Ford's controversial pardon of Nixon likely contributed to his narrow defeat in the 1976 presidential election to Jimmy Carter. In the long term, the public began trusting their government less, and the moderate wing of the Republican Party was greatly hurt due to Nixon and Ford being part of that wing. This was a major part of the Republican move more towards the right, a move that concluded with the election of conservative Ronald Reagan. It also caused the Democrats to move more towards the center, contributing to an overall rightward shift in the country for the next 30 years. This is also when people's cynicism towards Congress and the president began, and America's overall image declined. Nixon spent the rest of his life in peace, becoming something of a popular advisor even giving advice to President Bill Clinton. He died on April 22, 1994, at age 81. I believe that Nixon deleted the tapes himself based on his behavior in the grand jury and the erasures made after the car ride. In terms of what was discussed, I believe it likely had something to do with the strategy to avoid people from finding out about the scandal and more about how to hurt the Democrats' strategy. While the mystery of Watergate is overall solved, these missing 18 and a half minutes of the Nixon-Haldeman discussion remain unsolved for now. But with new technology, perhaps this case will be reopened, and maybe, just maybe, we will finally get to hear what was thought to be too bad for the public to hear in a new time.